A very good morning, ma'am, and a warm welcome to our guest speaker. Today we have with us Ms. Aditi Mukherjee, and she has joined us for the session today. Basically, we are conducting this EduTalk series where we invite guest speakers, educationists, elite group leaders to share their experience and inspire parents and teachers to create awareness about different parenting and teaching do's and don'ts. Inspire teachers to keep raising the standard and the bar of education, and also to become better professionals. And it aims at guiding parents to know how to develop the 21st century skills. Today we have with us our guest speaker as Ma'am Miss Aditi Mukherjee. She works as a principal at GEMS Academia International School. Previously, she worked at schools like Vibgyor High and Usha Martin. She completed her schooling from St. Joseph Convent, and she is an English major from University of Calcutta. We welcome you, ma'am, today, and thank you for being a part of the WASIN team and sharing your own personal experience to inspire the teachers and parents.
Thank you so much, Bhavya. Thank you for the brilliant introduction.
So, ma'am, before we get into the interview, I would like to ease up and have a little chat. We would cut after this. So, ma'am, what do you do nowadays? How do you indulge in activities? And, like, what hobbies you have adapted in this pandemic?
You really think that, after all these things, we are really being able to indulge in the hobbies? I don't think so. 24/7 is a short time to actually, connect with work. It's become really hectic, traveling and coming to school and meeting children and having a class is at least some schedule.
Yes.
But online is really, really difficult. It is absolutely, it's too much. So, no time is good time to, shut down on your computer and have a book in your hand and read, etc.
Yes,
so it's really, really difficult. Yeah, it's not actually difficult. It's very erratic, it's very, your lunch time, your cooking time, your home time is all overlapping. So,
ma'am, the absolute schedule has changed and we are always on screen consuming most of our time there only.
So either on the screen in the computer or some calls or some WhatsApp and something has happened and everything else. And then you keep trying to make things interesting for children. You have problems which you have to solve. So these things are continuing. Yeah, it's a different world altogether, a different lifestyle altogether now.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, we'll get into the interview. Like, as I've told you previously also, that we conduct these series so that we can tell the parents how to indulge their kids in activities and make them understand what are the necessary skills for the 21st century.
Yes.
So, ma'am, my first question would be that what was your journey been like? How did you come here? What inspired you to be a principal, a teacher to so many students?
I don't know. I the last I remember is I wanted to be a pilot or somebody in the army while I was in school. And somehow things didn't work out, or maybe, I did not get the right avenues. And the second best thing I always wanted to be was to be a teacher. So gradually, I went to college, I studied English, and then there was, during our times, quite a good demand of English teachers and English schools. So at the very, very beginning of my career, I joined a government organization. And then I realized that I don't think, I am being able to use all my skills in a government organization. So I left and then I joined a private organization. I joined Xavier's. And from then on, I just continued. And honestly speaking, Bhavna, my career as a teacher to a coordinator to a vice principal to a principal was, touch wood, quite easy. It was seamless. When I wanted to be a coordinator, I realized I can be a coordinator. I became a coordinator. I became a principal at the age of 34. So, and I was younger than most of my teachers at that point in time. And therefore, what happened was I grew with my teachers, with my organization. I was the principal of two, founding schools. It was from scratch, both Usha Martin and Vibgyor High Karpur. So it was very challenging, but it was very interesting and fulfilling as well.
It is very inspiring to hear that you have been a principal at the age of 34. It actually inspires me because I aspire to become a teacher.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am. Yes,
ma'am. That's great. That's great.
So, ma'am, next question would be that which fictional character or a real life hero was the one that admired you? Like, you were inspired and you wanted to become like one?
Yeah, see, Bhavna, this thing changes with time, you know. When I was in school, I remember initially, my English teacher was a great inspiration. If I keep aside my parent, my father, who was always an inspiration. So I can't recall one particular person other than my English teacher in grade 8 who actually inspired me. So in school, when I read history, I was pretty inspired with Mahatma Gandhi. I thought, you know, his kind of, leadership is rare and unique. You cannot, even compare that kind of leadership with anyone in the entire world. But, gradually I realized that then when I grew, I started admiring Arundhati a lot, you know, her way of writing. And I read Arundhati a lot. And later I appreciate Maya Angelou a lot. You know, I read her poems, almost all her poems. So I wouldn't say this is one static person or one static, fictional character. As and when I grew and as and when I read more and as and when I got involved into a lot of things, these names changed. But it's not like one to the other, but it's one with the other. So there are many people, you know. When I was reading Harry Potter, I was very inspired with, you know, the character.
Most of my generation is inspired by Harry
Potter. Yes, and I had to read Harry Potter because I had to discuss things with my son and, you know, the children in the school. So, yeah. You know, you have to keep abreast. So, you know, it's a lot of people inspiring, you know.
Ma'am, actually, every generation, every coming new person is evolving with some better and newer ideas.
Absolutely, absolutely. Now I'm pretty inspired with Nana Patekar, you know. I am reading him a lot. I'm seeing his videos and I'm like, oh, this is a man I did not know, you know. So it's different at different points of time.
Yes, ma'am. I would like to go to the next questions. What do you love doing during your free time? We have a lot of free time nowadays.
Not a lot of free time. But to be very honest, I am a movie buff. I watch a lot of movies. Yes, Netflix and Prime. And, in Bengal, we have Hoi Choi. So these are go-to things. And when I realize that I can spend 2 hours without being disturbed, I take up a book. So it would be movies and books, yes.
So ma'am, what genre do you prefer?
If you say about books, I do prefer non-fiction. I still cannot concentrate on a story anymore. So maybe, something has happened. So I prefer non-fiction. However, I'm reading post-independence history now. You know, post-partition history, to be very honest. Okay, and it's alarming what we don't know, what the historians have not written. So, and I recently watched a lot of movies. The last that I watched, I think, was Tufan. Yeah. So, whenever there's a release, I just watch it. And of course, now the Olympics. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, these are the events that are keeping us on our toes. At least we have something to look forward
to.
Yes. So ma'am, the next question would be, what is your role and what are your responsibilities? Like as a principal, there is a wide range of responsibilities. So majorly, what are you occupied by like day to day?
See, if you ask a mother, what are your responsibilities? Will she be able to tell you?
Everything is your responsibilities are just endless. So
the moment you get even before you enter the premises of your school, for instance, just a few days ago we had this problem with, you know, that West Bengal was voting for
election.
Yeah, so we had this problem here. So while I was traveling, I heard that, you know, there's police posting outside my gates, and you know, there was a problem and two party people were, you know, and so on and so forth. So it's always you have to be on your toes. So, and now that you're not seeing people, you're not with your staff, you know, you are not actually conducting a Monday morning meeting, you're just online. So things are, you have to be there everywhere. So mails, checking on children's performance, you know, now examinations and everything else. Bhavna, it's very difficult to actually restrict a principal's role, because we are teachers, we are nurses, we are helpers, we are sweepers. So everything, everything.
And ma'am, the problems have been increasing actually with this online.
It has. I just got a parent who, complained about a child being bullied on the internet and on the social media, maybe a timid child. So I will be very, very, now I have to enter the class and I have to address the class. And then I just thought that we should have cyberbullying sessions time and time again. We did have to, but we have to conduct more. So, you know, this is a new phase of life where we are also evolving, and the problems that are coming. See, generally what happens is a principal is a teacher for 10 years and then she becomes a principal. But now we've all started from zero. You have started from zero, I have started from zero, a child has started from zero. So being a principal, you have to be 0+1. You cannot help yourself. You have to be ahead of them. If somebody is bullying, you have to know how to stop the bully. You know? So it's everyday learning, and you have to
learn. And ma'am, your name would be highlighted the most, like the principal is not being responsible, or the principal is not responsible.
Not only that way, Bhavna, even a parent, you know, he is writing in caps that I expect only the principal to, you know, to coordinate and explain to the children.
Yes.
Because that is my responsibility, that is my duty. If a child in the school is being, you know, bullied, then yes, of course, it is my responsibility too.
Yes. Ma'am, and what is your typical day? Like we have discussed, like you have a lot of responsibilities besides being a teacher. Like what do you do at home? How do you indulge with your children, with your family?
I have a son who's just taken his ISC examination. So, you know, I know that mindset, what is going on in their minds now. So he's just taken his ISC examinations. Thankfully, he has a very good result this year. So, you know, I realize that, you know, I have to be there for my children when they see what is happening is these children who are in grade 10 and grade 12, they're missing out on a lot in life. They're going out of school without even meeting their friends, without even wearing that suit and their sari that they used to wear.
They're missing the farewell that they have been waiting for.
Yes, you know, those photographs, those fun day, that farewell, that, you know, the blessing ceremony, everything. They're poor children, actually. So we are planning certain things. So every day there's some planning or the other going on. And then there's 15th August. So you can't just, you know, being a school teacher, being children, you cannot just have a 15th August, which is a holiday. You know, it's very unlikely. So, you know, it's every day it's a planning, you know. So we're just planning about our investiture. We are planning how to give a proper farewell to our children. We're planning about 15th August. So along with this, along with regular academics, along with examinations, these are also things just to, you know, excite children that, you know, there is something going on, that life is still there and, you know, you will come back to school.
Yes, ma'am, because the extracurriculars were the things that actually motivated.
Yes.
For a point that they could, like, concentrate, divide.
Imagine the rehearsal that would go behind a 15th August program, the march pass, the drums, the drills, the pyramid, you know, but you have to do something. You have to substitute it with something else. So that's how we are planning.
Yes, ma'am, because the importance of extracurriculars have just been lost in all this time. Like we are just on reading books continuously in meetings here and there.
And when whatever you are doing, you have to tell a child, send a video. You know, and the video is restricted in the four walls of the house. So
yes,
maximum
ma'am.
You can go to the terrace or you can go to the garden and send a video. But
yes,
how
ma'am.
Good is that? You know, we were always, you know, 15th August means the school is, you know, the drums,
the entire school is practicing and everybody is on the ground.
Principal yelling, headmistress yelling, children yelling, captains, vice captains, you know, uniforms, so many things. It's sad. It's really sad.
Yes, ma'am, because these are the things that we will never get in life further. We might go to different places, but the essence of school is lost somewhere.
No. And once in college, it's no longer there. You don't have it. 15th August for everyone other than the school people, you know, is a holiday. For us, it's a preparation for a month. So it's never a holiday. This time also, 15th August, I think, is a Sunday. So, you know, but we will be doing something. I hope so. So it's a planning of a different order, you know. So
yes,
that
ma'am.
To be done.
Ma'am, because conducting something online is itself a very hectic task
now. It is. Not only hectic, it's a lot of planning. It's a lot of reorientation, you know. So
yes,
that is what it is. Yeah. What you've been doing for the past 15 years is no longer valid.
Actually, ma'am, we are on ground zero right now. It's like
Absolutely.
Something new we are starting.
Yeah, that's how.
So ma'am, what is your motivation like for every day? Like you get up in the morning.
Children. You know, that's how, you know, for every teacher, I think we get motivated with children. That's the only thing that is, you know, when suppose, you know, I'm sick or I'm not feeling well. My family members used to tell me, go to school after 1 hour, tell us whether you're still sick. which means you come to school, you get into the humdrum of the, you know, thing, and something has happened here, something's happened there, some child has done something good, and you forget about your own sickness.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, at what point in your life did you realize that you like to be surrounded by children, like you want to teach children?
Yeah, I told you, first I wanted to be, you know, I wanted to be in the army. I wanted to be a pilot, or at least, you know, in the army, in the defense forces. But somehow during our times, we did not have career counseling. We did not have these, you know, companies coming to us and telling us what you should study, how much you should get. Maybe I would have got stuck with my height, but nevertheless, so somehow or the other, the second best option was being a teacher. You know, and you know, these things that we do at home, you know, you teach the little ones that are there in your family, your servant's daughter, and I did all that. So I realized that, yeah, it's fun. You know, it's fun when you are, you know, something and you are imparting that knowledge to someone else, and that someone else is, you know, getting to do that. So that's quite fun. And that's how it started. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am.
And with children, you can never be old. You know, you have
ma'am, definitely, ma'am, because you are evolving with every new child.
Yeah,
you learn about the experience.
You will not be able to converse with a child if you do not know their language. You know,
definitely, ma'am. And ma'am, with the changing generation and the social media takeover, everybody is very different nowadays.
Absolutely, and children are very observant. You know, they'll observe what kind of haircut you have, what is the color of your hair, what kind of makeup you're putting on, and you need to be, you know, really with them. So, you know, otherwise they will respect you, but at one point of time they will think that, oh, that's old school. So you can't help but, you know.
Yes, ma'am, definitely you have to keep up with our generation, yeah. Because nowadays everything is first judged on outer appearance. Like whether the teacher is up to the mark, she's speaking that fluent English.
Yeah.
They'll never judge what your qualifications
absolutely. And that's how I've kept in touch with all my students, you know, who've left school. You know, now they're working in big companies and they're still saying, ma'am, do you still throw out notebooks when it's not covered and labeled? I said, no, I don't do that. It's not, you know, your generation was different. I did that, you know, if it's not covered and labeled, I would just throw out that, swing it out of the class. And they recall that. They don't recall the good things. They recall, ma'am, do you still do that? I said, no, I don't. I changed.
Ma'am, only those activities that make a teacher different are how she's scolding.
Yeah.
Or just the manner of speaking with the students in the class.
Absolutely. But, you know, later on in life, they realize that these were the good things.
Definitely, ma'am, because whatever we have studied, lived through the school life is just the best experience that we can ever have.
Absolutely, absolutely. We also remember our teachers, and maybe our best teachers have, you know, guided us to take up the subject that we have studied. I remember my English teacher so well, even this day. So, yeah.
Ma'am, because that person inspired you and you took English as a major and you have indulged yourself so much in that subject throughout your life.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, ma'am, this is a very, you know, like a different perspective of a question, that how do you go through a bad day? Like any experiences you would like to share that you are feeling like very low, or there is something happened at work which you aren't able to cope up at times. So how do you get through it?
See, there are many things that we have, which is like a life of a teacher, a life of a school administrator is not easy as it looks. You know, there was a time when people would think that being a teacher means 2 months of vacation and, you know, just going and having 5 or 4 periods and then coming back home. Your work hours are limited and so on and so forth. But the kind of after work that we have is very difficult. And, you know, 3 things. You have to keep your management happy, you have to keep children happy, and you have to keep parents happy. And they are 3 different poles. So, you know, you have to have, you have to keep on juggling. And previously, I don't think during our times, there was not so much of parental intervention. But now with online academics, you are sitting here, your teacher is sitting here, and your parent is sitting here. So even before this, you know, there was a lot of parental intervention. Which is a little difficult. It's very easy to deal with a child. It's difficult to deal with an adult, you know.
Definitely.
So, yes, I did have my rough days. I did have, you know, parents coming and yelling at my teachers. And there was this balance that had to be kept. And, you know, you are dealing with the microcosm of a society. A school has academic people, administrative people, leaders, children, parents, you know, every sector of society is in your, and what are you supposed to do? You are supposed to maintain a uniformity. You know, you have a rich man's child, you have a poor man's child, you have a business person's child, you have a, you know, service person's child. So it's very, very heterogeneous. And therefore, the leader has to have everything, a bit of everything, you know, and a bit of nothing.
Yes,
so this balance is very critical. It's not, it's, it can't even be explained how critical it is.
Ma'am, because it takes a mental toll also, like maintaining that uniformity,
yes,
keeping everybody happy, and at the end of the day, keeping yourself happy after servicing everyone.
And you cannot have a single day when you have, because that's, you know, you are teaching a child gender, you're teaching a child sensitivity, you're teaching a child animal love. Everything that you're teaching in school is actually building character. So you can't go wrong there. You can't go wrong there. And I would very, very easily, I can say this, that not all children have the parental backup, where whatever we teach, we go and see at home. They don't. We have children from separated homes, you know, but we have to manage these things. And every individual, every child for us is an individual. So managing that, you do have your bad days. You do feel sorry for so many things. But then again, you have to, you know, lift yourself up, and because they are, everybody is looking at you. They're looking at you for a solution. Ma'am ke room mein jayenge to theek ho jayega. So that is from the accounts, you know, till the person who's sweeping.
Yes, ma'am. So ma'am, do you feel any, like there is a peer pressure that you have to maintain amongst your staff members?
I wouldn't say I have to maintain, but yes, you know, I have to take, you know, there are so many things happening, Bhavna, in an organization now, which has infiltrated in our school also. You know, you have cyberbullying, you have a boxo, you have different genders in your school, you have so many things. So, you know, you have to be very sensitive and you have to know everything. You cannot relax in a chair and say that, oh, you know, academics over, exam over, result nikal gaya, fees aa gaya, bas ho gaya. You can't do that. There are so many things coming up every day. For instance, why am I taking this interview with you today? You know, I also want to understand whether, you know, the questions that you are asking is the answers that I would like to give, or I'm ready for the world. I'm attending this interview, I'm attending these webinars, so that when you are throwing questions at me, I am actually facing these questions. That means I'm introspecting. I'm asking myself, yes, what is a bad day for me? Yes, what is the balance that I'm doing? And when I'm answering you, I'm seeing so many pictures in front of me. And I'm making that into a beautiful picture and presenting it in front of you.
Yes, ma'am.
So it's introspection for me as well. So for a principal, you have to, you know, manage inside and outside.
Yeah. Now, because at times we are so much into our activities that we tend to just, you know, lose that communication.
Yes.
We're just indulging and we're doing this, that, and that communication is somewhere lost.
Somewhere in the entire fraternity, when, you know, when a teacher is not coming to school, you know that teacher has not come to school. But there are many teachers, and proudly say, who have had COVID and yet they continue to take class. Now, if I do not give them a personal call and ask, how are you doing? They will feel bad.
Definitely, you know? Ma'am.
And I will feel bad that teacher was suffering, yet she did her classes and I failed to recognize her effort. So, you know, it's a very, very...
Ma'am, it's just a process of appreciation and reciprocation that has been
going on. And it's micromanagement to the, you know, to the atomic level.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, what would you say that is the proudest moment of your journey? Like throughout your journey from being a coordinator to the vice principal to the principal. What would be the proudest moment where you felt like, yes, I can inspire some people?
See, I have a lot of, as teachers, we do have a lot of proud moments, you know, when your children have played for the country, they have played for the states. Those are, and you know, we always say that a teacher feels proud in other person's achievement. In no other profession will you find this, you know.
Yes,
ma'am. You do well, people will tell you. For us, somebody else is doing well, my child is doing well, oh, a school ka principal hai, you know, that school's child. So that,
ma'am, that entire, it becomes a badge for us, that we are walking with that badge, with that,
absolutely, cape. Absolutely, that is of course there, and every year this happens when we have, you know, children representing us, or when we have a very sad need support child doing well in class. Those are there. But I think one thing I would really, really take pride in is when we had a major problem in Bangalore school. You know, you must be remembering there was a major incident that had happened. And then, you know, we had these parents who had, you know, come in in groups. And I had faced the parents single-handedly because I had kept my teachers, inside the room. I said, you wait, if I need you, I will call you. And I faced almost 500 parents together. And that is a point of time when they had lost faith in the school and lost faith in the leadership. And I talked to them from 10 o'clock in the morning till 6 o'clock in the evening, And at 6 o'clock, there was a few parents who came to me and said, ma'am, drink your water and drink your tea. And then I felt, okay, so conversation and interaction and from doubt to faith for a fraternity of, of 500, 600 parents was a big deal. And I was really, really feeling proud of myself that day.
Yes, ma'am, at times happen that there is such a diverse group of children. They have diverse group of parents. Yes. And sometimes they just let it out on teachers. Yes. And being there, their responsibility, but they won't take up for it.
Yes. And when at 6 o'clock in the evening, when I went back to my room, I saw all my teachers waiting for me. They did not go home because they knew that ma'am is facing the parents. And so we have to be there with her. No, it's a different feeling. It's a different pride altogether.
Ma'am, because most of your life, what we work for is like respect, gaining the respect of each person that we are servicing.
And if she needs, she'll call us. So I have to be there for her, So that bonding was created. I realized that, yes, the bonding that, you are the center. You have your teachers on one side, you have your parents on one side, you have your children on one side. So that bonding is you. They will look at you and believe in life. So yes. If that is done, then you have done a good job.
Ma'am, having each other's back is also a very important part
very
of
the community. Very important. In any sector, very important.
So, ma'am, next question would be that in your opinion, why do you think that the 21st century skills are important? Why the parents and teachers and all, other people also in a children's life need to learn these skills? What would your opinion?
There is a very cliched saying that we always tell that, 10 years down the line, 20 years down the line, you don't even know, what job you're going to enter in. Like now we have this essay we used to write, what do you want to be in life? And 70% of children would write, I want to be a doctor. Few would write, I want to be an engineer. And few would write, I want to be a, these professions were known to us. Tomorrow, we don't know what profession we are going to actually, get into. So preparing these children, you're not preparing them for a particular thing. You're preparing them for a particular way of life. So what is it that you're preparing them for? You are preparing them to work together. You're preparing them to be compassionate. You're preparing them to communicate. You're telling them that, look, there's enough space for everybody. So you don't have to compete. You have to collaborate. So these things have a lot of impact in a child's life now. And information bombarding is always happening. Right. In a click of a mouse, you are doing everything. So I cannot go into the class and say that, what happened to Mary Kom? Everybody knows what happened to her. But what are you teaching them then? So from a girl who was, struggling to a girl who's maybe, topping the world, what was her journey like? What are we learning from there? So that is what is the lesson that we are teaching our children. And that's not an easy task. That's a very big task. So these are 21st century skills.
I'm basically taking out the message out of somebody's story and helping children to build that in their personality so that they can face the world.
Yes, it's the wisdom now. And, previously you would say, okay, this child has stood first. So something will happen in her life. No longer. You say 97.5%. How many people have got? 1,000 children have got that same 97%.
Yes, ma'am.
One school has got 99.99% as the topper. How many children in that category? 99.99? Maybe 100. So achievement, the definition of achievement has changed today. No longer. Can you imagine 97.8 in your time also?
No, ma'am. Our topper had 95% in science.
Yeah. And maybe, so now if you see these marks, you will realize that, they are like they say, it's like temporary.
I mean, it seems so easy actually nowadays, scoring 74, like 97, 98. Like the other day we had an ISC result and they sent me a list. So there were 10 children in that span of like 99 to 98 only, there were 10 children.
So now how will these children progress in life? how will they do better in life? They have already had their academics marks, right?
Yes.
Now, you know, tomorrow, what are you going to teach them? What are you going to teach a child who knows everything? Because he has access to everything. You don't have to teach a child information. So what have you to teach a child? You have to teach a child to collaborate. That's how the classroom is. You have to teach a child to, you know, help another one when there is a need. You have to teach a child to be sad. How to control yourself, how to conduct yourself when things are not in your, you know, periphery. Because you can order a pizza, but you cannot order happiness.
Definitely, yeah? Ma'am. Definitely.
So these things, you have to teach a child what the internet will not teach you.
And ma'am, nowadays, like, internet, just one access, type, and we have everything. But the problem is we do not have the essence. Like, what is the message behind that story? Or what do we learn from that particular history chapter that we have been studying for so many years? We do not know that unless somebody tells us from a very different perspective.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And therefore, the discussion, and therefore, the collaboration, and therefore, the coordination, and therefore, the communication is so important.
Ma'am, because nowadays many children are lagging behind, like, since we are on this platform, introverted children are not even getting a chance to ask a question, due to which they are becoming more scared to face the world. Even just to say, like, good morning to a teacher is Absolutely. Very difficult for them.
And imagine pre-primary children. Do you even think that this is the way that they should be taught?
Definitely, ma'am. And ma'am, not all parents are that much qualified to conduct so many activities, buy a lot of things to teach the child.
No. And, you know, children are made, we are all made for touch and feel. You know, we need to talk, run. You know, when you have a problem with your parents, with anyone, what do? You sit over a cup of coffee and you talk. And you see each other and you fix the problem. But now it's not like that. You know, one day in our pre-primary section, I took these children around and I showed them their didis. You know, the didi who would, and they were like super excited to see them. You know, generally in a classroom, you don't see them in an online classroom. But they were so close to them. You know, they would go to the toilet with them. They would go to the playground with them. And then I realized that, okay, let me show. And the didis were also so happy to see the children because I showed them, see, this is how this was. And it was a different feeling altogether. Everybody's so excited. When I take class in school, unlike when I take class at home, you know, children will tell me, ma'am, please take us to the playground. So I have to take this laptop and I have to go to the back, playground, and I have to take a class.
Yes, ma'am.
They miss school, they miss the ambience, they miss the
ma'am, that physical contact is missing somewhere. Like, sitting at home, attending class, you are leaving the meeting, nobody knows of it. But in the class, there is interaction.
Yes.
Something is going on in one corner. Yes,
so
ma'am.
Fun. Somebody sitting in somebody's place, somebody going to somewhere, somebody going to the toilet, somebody going, you know, drinking water and not coming back. So many things happening, which, you know, is a part
of it. It is chaotic and it is fun at the same time.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
I would like you, what are the two things that you would suggest the parents that they can help develop these skills? Like, just two things at the top of your mind.
See, that is what I always say, communicate. You know, the children have their own lives. They have their own systems. They have their own phones. They have their own group of people. And the parents often feel, you know, delineated from them. So the only way that they can, you know, have a role in the children's life is to communicate. Like I told you, you know, I am watching movies that maybe my children will watch. You know, so I can just open, you know, YouTube and watch Dharmendra, Amitabh Bachchan, Uttam Kumar movies. But I know that this way I cannot communicate with my children. So they will ask me about something which is happening today. So, you know, just as much as children are, involved in learning, so must parents also always be involved in learning so that I can touch that right chord. So that when the parent, when the child is talking of Captain America, I will be able to understand. You know,
yes,
when they are talking of Messi, I must be able to, you know, understand. So a little bit of homework from my end, and that high pedestal parenting is gone. So you have to be on the same page, you know, with children.
Like, usually we say that parents cannot be friends, but I do not believe that. If you maintain that sort of a relationship, you can definitely be friends with your children.
You have to. See, friendship is an emotion which goes with everyone. A teacher is a friend. You and I will become friends. You know, parents will. There is that emotion should be there in everyone. So a part of your parenting is definitely friendship. otherwise,
because just to have that connect, you have to be like a child with a child, an elder with an elder, so that you have that build of the bond, you know.
Absolutely. And you know, Bhavya, though we think that our children are very happy because they have so many things, they have friends, they don't need us, there is nothing more untrue than this. Every child needs an adult to say that, okay, go, I'm there behind you. Win or lose, I'm there behind you. That is a very, very important thing. We should not think, he's there, he has friends, he has the phone, he has the laptop. Oh, wo kya karta hai sara din, mujhe pata bhi nahi hai, madam. Kya pata nahi, kya game khelta hai. Pata kijiye, please ask, you know, because deep down, all of us are very lonely. All of us need human companionship. All of us need friendship and all of us need love. That's very important.
Definitely, ma'am. And we also need some adult, you know, advice, the experience, like you are sharing your experience. I will definitely take so much from this experience and I will impart to people, like maybe I'll teach or whatever career that I choose. Yes. At least I'll have that thing that my teacher taught me that. Yes. My parents.
Last day there was a child whom I called for discipline issues. Yeah, I called the parent and I called the child. So the parent, for the 5 minutes, he went on saying, "Patta bhi nahi hai, kya karta?" There's a typical dialogue that parents give. So I said, "Aap please wait kijiye. Let me talk with the child." And I realized while talking to him that he's very interested in, you know, cryptocurrency. And I was like, really? And then I started talking to him about cryptocurrency. You should see his body language, his face, everything changed. At the end of the conversation, I told him, look, I will learn cryptocurrency from you, but you should learn business studies from your teacher. You know, this is a transaction.
Yes,
and like, you know, maybe 1%, but still the child felt, okay, I know something better than my principal, you know, and she's wanting to learn. So there's no harm in me also learning something and I don't know. So you have to, you know, make yourself vulnerable. You're all very vulnerable people, aren't we?
Yes, I'm presenting that strong core and acting like that strong-headed adult will not have that connect with your parent or even a teacher also.
Will it work with your friend? Will it work with your friend? You've gone on to have
not.
So if your friend shows that, oh, I know better than you, I look better than you, I have better dress sense than you, next day you will not go out with them.
Ma'am, we have to ease into the conversation, you know, for some person to like be completely into it.
Absolutely. So children are looking for love. They are looking for companionship and we have to give that to them. That's
definitely, ma'am. So ma'am, what would you say would be two activities that the teachers could also help students to develop their skills?
Same thing, Bhavya. You know, I would say the transition from competition to collaboration is very important. You know, I don't like announcing toppers, you know, because what is a topper? And that moment you got 98 point whatever, you know, but the person who's just next to you is not any less than you. Maybe on a different day, that person would have scored more than you. But if these two brains come together, imagine what magic they can do. So yes, from competition to collaboration is always what I say. And teachers are no longer people who know more. Those ages are gone. We are just experienced more. We can just facilitate, you know. We can just share some wisdom. We can just warn. We do not know more than them. You tell them one document you give them, they will give you 15 documents. Because it's all available now. So that is what I tell teachers, communicate and collaborate. And these are things that are, you know. And one more thing, Bhavya, I would also like to add here.
Yes, ma'am.
To teach children to learn to fail. I think we are all in such a tight compartment that we are all feeling that, you know, everybody and every day we should win. And things are coming so easy to us. You're hungry, you just order. You know, you want to see a movie, you just click off a mouse, you just enter your Netflix. You don't have to wait for anything. But in life, to be successful, you have to wait.
Ma'am, the struggle actually that children are actually not realizing right now, sitting at home, getting everything. And you know, at the end of the day, they know that they'll copy from somewhere or they just mix it all and they'll get marks that are necessary for passing.
Absolutely correct. But then life will have a different story to tell you. Right. If you have COVID, you have to wait for 15 days to cure yourself.
Yes, ma'am.
You have no quick fix to that. So teaching children to fail and teaching children patience and waiting is very important. which I think even we are lacking these days.
Yes, ma'am, like that patience is gone. We are so in haste to just finish everything. Let's go on another thing.
Or we need time getting everything. You know, we are getting everything. You are sitting where? Where are you now?
I'm in Agra.
So just imagine. You and I are chatting as if we are in the same room. You know, you are in Agra and I'm in Kolkata. So, you know, even 5 years before, we couldn't imagine this conversation happening. You know, either you had to come down or I had to go.
Yes, ma'am.
But now it's everything is so easy. It's just in the click of a mouse. So, you know, the other side, the flip side of life must be taught.
And ma'am, I guess that pros and cons is something that people should learn. Like everything has a pro and a con. So that should also be taken into consideration.
And sometimes you don't even know what is the pros and what is the con.
Yes, ma'am.
Or you might be unaware. But you have to, you know, wait for 9 months to deliver a baby. You cannot have a click of a mouse. So yes, there are certain things in life and the most important things in life for which you have to wait. That is a good lesson we can teach our children.
Yes, ma'am. And ma'am, besides that, like people nowadays are lagging behind in so many, like nobody is indulging to understand what is general knowledge, what is going on in our country, what are our responsibilities as a citizen, because they think we are sitting at home, we can just do nothing. It's better to just sit at home and do whatever we have given for a day.
Absolutely. Yes. Yes. See, especially in our school, Bhavya, we have affluent children, you know, they come from good families. They come from affluent families. But these are the things also I tell teachers. For instance, in a sociology class, you cannot have a sociology class without telling your children, you know, the plight of the farmers, you know, the plight of the daily laborers. You have to bring in this sensitivity. You have to make them aware, not only politically, but also socially and economically. So sitting in front of a system in an AC room, you are generally not aware. Here, when you come to school, you at least see the bhaiyas and the didis and you know that, you know, they are cooking for you. We used to have this once in a month. Children would serve food to the teachers and to the staff.
I just have another question that, can you tell a time in your life where you came across a very difficult challenge, like a very difficult part that you know, overcame and became a lot stronger? So would you recall that? Would you like to share it with us?
As teachers or being in the humanities department, I hardly knew a lot of law, you know. But and as a principal, you're not generally expected to know the IPC or, you know, the general law or something or the other. So now every day we are evolving, and now every day your problems are new. And it's not only restricted to the classroom. So I have had a lot of problems in different schools that I worked with when it became, you know, it escalated to becoming legal problems. Yeah. So I had to report to the police. I had to, you know, play the role of a lawyer. I had to take, you know, decisions on the spot. You know, these things, when you're on the right, it's easy, though it's easy. But you need to know a lot of things that is beyond the periphery of being a teacher of a particular subject. You know, nowadays, we don't trust a school as much as you and I trusted the school or our parents trusted school. You know, because of so many incidents happening around, I wouldn't blame parents. Even I'm a parent, so I know what goes on inside the school. But there are so many people a person has to deal with, you know, and certain things are beyond you because you can't be everywhere. So these are intuitions that you have to build up on. These are trust levels that you have to have. And these are certain trainings and workshops and lessons and talk and conversation that you have to have with your staff members. Now, there will be someone who will fail. There will be someone who might miss out. Yeah. So, so you know, the fact of corporal punishment, the touch of no touch policy, the touch of POXO, these are very sensitive issues, you know. The CCTV camera in every single, I remember, you know, we used to have these debate topics. Should there be CCTV cameras in the schools? Now you cannot imagine a well-established school without a CCTV camera, you know. And, you know, reflection in the CCTV camera does not give you every single picture. You know, so there is something called data, there is something called extracting information from data, and there is something called the human factor. So there were many times when I had to, you know, take very tough calls, maybe calls which from my deep inside I knew that, you know, this is to save my school, to save many things. But in the long run, you know, maybe I don't know whether it was right or wrong. So there are many things where both sides are right, you know, and that is a difficult situation where externalities are what you are guided by. You're not guided by your intuitions, by your emotions. You're guided by law, you're guided by facts, you're guided by, you know, data. So those are times when you have to take very tough calls. And yes, when
you know, nowadays people are very skeptical and cynical about so many incidents that they have become like they are behind that border. They are very fearful to cross that limit actually nowadays. So it takes a lot of power.
Even a simple thing like, why are you eating food in the class? You know, I cannot imagine me being brought up in a Christian missionary school. I cannot imagine, you know, munching food in the class and my teacher, you know, ignoring that. But now there are two things, you know. One is, oh, the child was hungry and you did not allow the child to eat. Yeah. Or the child wanted to go to the washroom and he has high diabetes. You did not allow the child to go to the washroom. So there's a very fine balance. And believe me, Bhavya, our teachers are learning every day. And it's a very fine balance. Will you allow the child to miss out on class and be truant? Or will you think that, oh my, the child might have... So what would we do? 15th August, I was talking of 15th August. And I remember my headmistress telling me, march until you faint and fall. And there were children who fainted and fell. And, you know, we took them up and we sent them to the infirmary. Enough. You do this now, the entire child rights will come to you.
Yes, ma'am. And ma'am, because people are actually very well aware right now of the situation. Yeah.
I don't know whether this is awareness or whether this is, I don't know what this is. But then, you know, will a child not play? Will you not punish a child, or will you not force a child to go and play in the field? As a Nova School teacher, I will say that your academics is as important as your sports. But then, you know, something happens. A child was sick on that particular day. So you are responsible. So it's a very, very fine balance between, and what are we doing as teachers? We want the best of our children.
Definitely.
And we have some set things in our head. But what do you do when legality comes in? What do you do when child rights comes in? What do you do when the police comes in? What do you do when the court comes in? That is not what was, but now it is. You know, you can't even... You know, one day I was giving a no-touch policy to my pre-primary children, teachers. And the coordinator herself and 3-4 teachers, they started crying. I'm giving this to you as an example. It is for everyone to listen to. And then I said, what on earth did I do? I'm feeling like, what did I say? Why are these teachers crying? I said, what happened, Sharmila? She said, ma'am, that means when a child does something wrong or right, I cannot hug him or her. You know, and they can't imagine going inside a classroom and not hugging a child and saying, wow, well done. Or, you know, hugging a child and saying, today this does not happen, tomorrow it will happen. When I'm telling them, no, you will not touch. You know, you will do it from far. They're crying, they're weeping. And this is no exaggeration, Bhavya. I said, no, dear, don't do it. Because you never know, you know, a parent can come and say that your teacher hugged my child, you know, pressed my child so hard that she had a heart problem. Happens.
Definitely, ma'am. Ma'am, sometimes your teacher is walking by and you are suddenly just a friction is there. You walk by, you touch hands. People take it in another way that he was touching in a bad way. And especially with male teachers, there's a lot of
imagine men folk in the school. Imagine the men folk in the school, they are petrified. You know, if anything
happens, definitely,
you know,
ma'am,
they can be, you know, penalized. Yeah. So that these are some incidents, Bhavya, I did have to face, and I did have to take some strong calls. Maybe I still don't know whether it was right or wrong.
Yes, ma'am. So ma'am, I would come to the last question of our session, that what according to you would be like 3 or 4, like just some adjectives that are necessary to build like a very safe environment for working, for developing these skills. Like we say, a socially safe work environment. So what would you suggest would be that perfect environment to exist in?
Bhavya, we do not have any perfect environment, you know. Even God has not made the world to be perfect. the imperfection is the beauty of this world. We are all imperfect people, and that is why we are beautiful. You know, I'm a little fat, you are a little thin, somebody is a little, you know, squinted, and somebody has fallen hair. But what do we do? We make good use of this imperfection. If everyone was perfect, would you need a school? If everyone was perfect, would you need a teacher? And if every teacher was perfect, would you need a principal? If the principal was perfect, would you need a director? And if you needed a director, would you have the human rights? So no one is perfect. So we do not have, you know, exactly the language of imperfection. We have to tell everyone, and we have to tell ourselves, that it's very beautiful to be not beautiful in every sense of the term. That is what life is. You are changing every day, you're evolving every day. So I would like to lay stress on the word evolve. You know, you're learning. Today you're selfish, you are not sharing your food with your friends. Tomorrow you realize that I did not find pleasure in eating my lunch alone. I think having with all my other five friends, and you know, the other friends saying, oh, your mother makes such good sandwich, was a better feeling. So the next day I will share.
Yes, ma'am. And Nati actually say that being kind is easy, but being kind is actually the most difficult thing that you can actually do.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But also the most beautiful thing.
Yes, ma'am.
When you know how to be kind, and when you can be kind, you realize that it's the most beautiful thing. So, Bhavya, I would like to say that we should all accept that we are not perfect people. We cannot live alone, and we have to have everyone around us to make us perfect.
Definitely, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your own experience, your own challenges and everything with us. It has been just a wonderful interview, and I have learned so many things that I would really, you know, if I become a teacher someday, I would definitely teach my students as well. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being a part.
Aditya was right in saying that you take good interviews, because you extracted a lot of emotion from me. I don't know whether it was, you know, a perfect interview, but definitely it was a very animated interview.
Ma'am, at least we have that interaction, the communication that we are lacking nowadays. Yes. It's very necessary. Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your valuable time.
Thank you, Bhavya. Thank you so much.
Thank you.